Mr. Harris to the podium.
Thank you, Mrs. Pratt. We say good morning to all of you on behalf of Metro Social Services and the chair, as I am the chair of the board. We welcome you here to our seventh annual evaluation of our needs in our community. We have documentation to provide nationwide information to assist in doing that that we need to do in the city of Nashville. Demographics as well as sociology. We can evaluate what we have, what we are doing, and how to make it better. To give a deeper understanding of all that is needed in the city of Nashville. One thing that we have learned is poverty is certainly rampant across the country in the city of Nashville. We find that 19.9% of poverty here in the city of Nashville. Poverty is damaging our communities as well as our people. And we must understand that poverty hits no one. We all can fall under that umbrella of poverty. It is damaging to the individual. And so let us continue to do all we can. We assess our needs today and do all we can to make the city of Nashville the thriving city that they say it is, but make it a thriving city for everyone. God bless you. We thank you.
It has links to everything that we discuss in there. It has a wide variety of information that includes demographic, social, socioeconomic, poverty, and other kinds of data that shows the disparity in Davidson County. It has information about specific areas, including aging and disability, food and nutrition, housing and neighborhoods, health and human development, and workforce and economic opportunity. It's important because it specifically focuses on Davidson County. It provides insight into the community and the people who live there so that we can have a better understanding of what they need. It provides data from reliable sources, and we use the most current data that we have. In addition to the data, we provide analysis to help explain what some of it means. This provides us a foundation of facts on which to make decisions for programs, strategies, and priorities. The population of Davidson County is now almost 670,000 people. And I'm going to mention something about education because it is so important. You'll hear it referred to again. High school graduates, we have over 87%, but we also have 37% who have bachelor's degrees. Davidson County is a young county. We have a median age of 34.4 years, which is 3 to 4 years younger than that, the median age in both Tennessee and the United States. The percentage who are 65 or older is 11.1, also lower than Tennessee and the United States. This slide shows the per capita, which is per person, and the median household income. Median means 50% above, 50% below, and household is a group of people living together, related or not related. As you can see, the household income is the typical pattern that we have in the United States is the highest, Tennessee's is the lowest, and Davidson County is somewhere in between. And we, if you look at that number in green, that is a departure from that pattern. This is one of the few cases in which Davidson County is better off than the United States. Our per capita income is over $29,000. A family is a group of people who live together who are related by blood or marriage. And you would hope that in a family, the more children there were, the more income there would be, but that's not the case. And the families that have children, they have a 42,000 median income for the family. But in families that do not have children, it's more than 70,000. This shows the median income for workers. And these are people who get their income specifically from working at a job. This will show a pattern that will be repeated throughout the data in the presentation, as well as the data that is in the book. The white population's median income is almost twice what the black population is, with Hispanics in between. This shows median income. It shows the income of people who have incomes under $25,000. And there are households with incomes, there are 68,000 plus households that have incomes less than $25,000. There are also more than 30,000 households that live on less than $15,000. You see that the white population is about half the number that have the under 25,000 for the white population and black population. Just look at the difference. This is a chart that's in your books. It's the federal poverty guidelines. And I just show it to remind you how low this is. For one person, less than $12,000. For four people, a little over $24,000. So it's very, very low. It's an outdated measure, but it's all we have. There is a fairly new supplemental poverty measure, but at this point it's used only for research, not for eligibility. Let's look at the percentage of poverty in Davidson County. And as you can see, the highest poverty rate was back in 2010 following the recession. And it has dropped a few years since then, but 2014, it went back up. And the reason we're using 2014 data is because that is the newest available from the census. At the end of each year, they start counting and tabulating, and they release the information at the end of the following year. This is the data that we discussed, came out between September and December this past year. So there won't be anything new until this coming September and December. This goes a little further back and shows how many fewer people there were in poverty some years ago. But if you look at 2010, you'll see that there were 121,000 people in poverty, and that's when the poverty rate was the highest at 20.2. But if you come forward to 2014, even though the poverty rate is just a little bit lower at 19.9%, the number of people in poverty is higher than ever in Davidson County, more than ever before. The poverty rate itself was higher in 2010, and it's still very high, and it is the highest since they started the war on poverty over 50 years ago. In addition to Census Bureau of Labor Statistics and other governmental and research sources, we have local data. Each year we conduct a grassroots community survey where we go into other agencies, and many of your agencies may have participated. If you're interested in participating this year, let us know. We have a short two-page survey that we ask the people to complete anonymously, and it identifies among the different issue areas which specific things they need, and then when looking across all the issue areas, we ask people to identify the greatest gap in services. And you're going to hear a little more about this just a little bit later. But what we have found year after year is that generally the main top unmet need that's indicated as a gap in service is housing and neighborhood, or excuse me, housing and related assistance. And that particularly means when they drill down to the next level, that means assistance with rent and utilities. Secondly, we find that workforce issues are the second most, is the second greatest gap in service, and sometimes it comes up to the top. We also do a front desk survey. You'll hear a little bit more about that later, but it affirms the same thing. United Way's 211, over 40% every year, have basic needs as the primary issues. Again, education makes a great deal of difference. If you look at the difference, there's a huge difference between the people who have high school and the people who have bachelor's degrees. Several times difference. This shows a chart, and there's one of these in your book also, that just shows the range of poverty across categories that are higher than for all people. And if you refer to your book, you'll see that in some cases there's a huge variation, particularly the highest categories, families that have five or more children. This map shows the geographic distribution of poverty, showing the disparity across Davidson County. And I want to mention a couple of things from the 2013 needs evaluation, which is about the neuroscientific findings that poverty can create stress that impairs cognitive ability. Even worse for children. They begin school behind and they stay that way. They're a third less likely to graduate from high school. In terms of poverty, a third of Davidson County's children are in poverty. That's more than 47,000 people. Stress makes everybody sick. It makes us physically sick, mentally sick, emotionally sick. Adverse childhood experiences are another form of toxic stress, and these need to be addressed as well. But there is hope. There's evidence-based practices. We can do what works. We can use the new research. We have a choice. We can keep doing what we've done, or we can look at the evidence and find a way to do things better. I'd like to introduce to you now Julius Witherspoon, who will begin with a presentation on aging and disability, followed by food and nutrition. Thank you.
A point of personal privileges. For those who are standing, there are some seats which may give the technician a little bit of time to see if we can fix the screen. Well, we're doing the best we can. We have a suggestion if you will give us a minute. Thank you for your patience. If you don't know, just ask. Thank you all. Again, Julius Witherspoon with Metropolitan Social Service. It's so good to see so many friends and colleagues out here. Let me see if we can get started with aging and disability. The screen. It's okay, we gotta go with it. It's true, it is not about me. But again, good morning. Thank you for bearing with us with some technical difficulty. Aging and disability, when we talk about it, What we do know is either you're going to need a caregiver or you are a caregiver as we look forward to our aging, our golden year. Where do our seniors live in Davidson County? Our seniors live, but our seniors live in the suburban areas of Davidson County, which means that with our expanding senior population, what we found is the challenges for seniors now are addressed through, you know, challenges with transportation, challenges with healthcare access, and housing. If you think about it, our seniors have to come into town primarily for their health care, and they've got transportation challenges, particularly for low-income seniors. The second one is kind of a profile of what do our seniors look like here in Davidson County. In 2013, if you made it to age 65, you had a life expectancy of another 19.3 years. If, and we know of the statistics of 10,000 seniors turning age 65 every day, when you look at the median income of persons age 65 and over, it's 29,000. And it, as Dinah said earlier, our population is somewhere in the neighborhood of 49,000 for all others. So you see some of the struggles that particularly low-income seniors have. And how it's headed by seniors is 51,000. While it sounds high, it actually is 59,000 for Davidson County as a whole. So our seniors continue to struggle. If you look at the number, this slide is really messing me up. if you look at the numbers of seniors, what we talk about, there's two ways to measure poverty, the supplemental poverty measure and the official poverty measure. The official poverty measure is so old, back in 1965, that it really doesn't reflect truly what happens for our seniors. The supplemental poverty measure will show that the majority of our seniors, when you take into account medical expenses and out-of-pocket expenses, our seniors continue to struggle. Falls continue to be a major part of our issue here in Davidson County. There are many Americans, especially older adults, who are not prepared for retirement, and we'll speak a little bit about that in a moment. Again, the poverty measure, when you look at just the supplemental poverty measure and the official poverty measure, the official poverty measure is in blue, the supplemental is in green. You'll see that it's higher, particularly for older adults, because the blue does not take into account out-of-pocket medical expenses, transportation costs. So if you look at it, we have more seniors in reality in poverty, particularly in Davidson County and across the state of Tennessee. Falls continue to be a major issue for seniors. How many of you all know someone or had someone with a recent knee or hip surgery replacement? Whoa. It continues to be, when we look at falls, 250,000 older adults are hospitalized for falls. 2.5 million are treated in emergency room. And we spend $34 billion in our healthcare costs simply on falls as a result of lower body weaknesses, walking difficulty, and vision problems, and in some cases, foot pain. To retirement, we call it unprepared for retirement. Many old adults, especially old adults who are not, we find 20% are not prepared, particularly age 55 and 64, are not prepared for retirement. That means that, and then one third of those working adults have no pension or savings in preparation for retirement. We have this American dream that our golden years will be our golden years. And in reality, for many of our seniors, that's just not true. When we look at what seniors spend their basic expenses on, you'll see in the gray, the blue, and the purple, those are just basic living expenses that we find that 65% of seniors' income is spent on just basic living expenses. And what we find is that leaves little, if any, money for what we call vacations, raising grandchildren, or just quality of life issues. It's just not happening for our seniors. Particularly low-income seniors in Davidson County. Disability, there's a direct correlation between persons with a disability and employment and in poverty. If you look at that screen, with no disability persons are better off, particularly at their higher employment rate. And if you look at it, they're more likely to be in poverty just simply as a result of disability. And what we find is 20%, at least 20% of the people in Davidson County has some form of disability, with the largest percentage of those with ambulatory or walking difficulties. When we look at our 10 care choices, this is 10 care choices data from 2005 to 2015. When you look at it, you'll see that in 2005, just 11 years ago, Tennessee was spending the majority of their long-term services and support money. So you literally had to go to a nursing home to receive it. Just 11 years later, you'll see that that number has went from 97 to 60%. And most seniors, just like us, we would prefer to age in place or age at home, particularly for our disabilities. But it's all connected. It really is all connected. If you're older adult, when you talk about the workforce, typically many of our older adults in low income work low skilled jobs. Thus, they were not able to save retirement and depend upon Medicaid and Medicare for their healthcare needs. And in housing, while home ownership for seniors is the highest, it also presents problems when they have to have potentially costly repairs and high property taxes. Health and human development, while baby boomers are the second fastest growing generation, they are the generation that has the most chronic diseases in obesity, heart disease, and diabetes. I want to quickly switch to food and nutrition. Depend upon where you live in Davidson County, depend and your income. It depends upon, it is directly related to the access you have to affordable, healthy food. When we look at SNAP beneficiaries, we find that SNAP beneficiaries earn three times less than the typical medium income that we find in Davidson County. And we find one in six of our seniors are facing the threat of hunger, meaning they are not sure where their next meal is coming from. When we look at what we call low food access, the green shows that the persons of people with low income, most of them, you'll see they are a mile away from the nearest full service grocery store. While that may not sound like a lot to us, try getting on the bus, try lugging groceries within a mile. The orange, which is much larger, they're half a mile. Same kind of challenges. In preparation for low food access, you'll see that Davidson County is a little better than Tennessee, but higher than the national average, meaning that people can have enough food for a healthy, active lifestyle at all times for every member of their family. That's just not true for particularly our low-income persons. When we look at food insecure households, you'll see that they're in the South and Southwest, and you'll kind of see the characteristics of where they are, with 14% of those households food insecure, and one in five children who live in those households are food insecure as well. The U.S. Conference of Mayors conducts an annual hunger and homeless survey. Nashville is one of those 27 cities that is surveyed. And when you look at the characteristics of people who request food assistance, according to the survey, 70% of families, 9% of elderly, 21% of unemployed, 5% of homeless. Well, we may think that that may be a little bit different. What that really means is that the food assistance that's requested is in some cases handled by our nonprofit agencies. When we look at SNAP, this is SNAP participation rates across the United States, Tennessee and Davidson County. Davidson County is in green, Tennessee is in red, and the United States is in purple. You'll see that between the 2012 and 14, while we fluctuate, our SNAP participation rate is high. In Davidson County, we have one of the highest participation in SNAP program, that is, thanks to many other nonprofits such as Community Food Advocates, Second Harvest, and those working to ensure that that the persons who are eligible for SNAP benefits get those. You'll see what SNAP recipients live by councilmatic districts. For those council persons, if you'll look, you'll see where your councilmatic district is, and it overlays the map based on poverty and where our seniors live, and also where low employment exists. Again, it's all connected. Depending upon where you live, your access to food is limited. Your access to nutrition and healthy food is limited. Many of the people on that map, by their primary grocery option is a corner store that really markets tobacco and alcohol products, not healthy food. And in health and human development, we know that if our children do not eat early and healthy food, we know the dangers of that as they grow. Flint water is one of those examples. Last but not least, unemployed and low-skilled workers spend an enormous amount of their income on basic living expenses. Food is while it is a necessity, it is certainly a luxury when you talk about affordable food and access. All things are not bad. Brockton, Massachusetts addressed this disparity in one way by having a healthy food store connected to a medical clinic. There's no good for a doctor to tell you to go buy healthy food and he or she not know that you have a problem with access. So they put the grocery store right next to the health clinic under the same roof. And then City Slicker Farms in West Oakland use vacant lots and to teach people to grow food. We tried those here in Davidson County with some success, but we could learn from what they've done in West Oakland. Thank you all so much. I now want to introduce my colleague, Joyce Hillman.
Good morning. I'm Joyce Hillman, and I'll be presenting the highlights of the Health and Human Development section. And we appreciate your patience in working with us as we work through our technical challenges today. In Davidson County in 2015, we had over 98,000 people that were uninsured. And you may not be able to see this map, but the area represented in orange and yellow, or orange and red, are actually the areas where the highest percentage of uninsured people live. That age group in particular is ages 18 to 64. Also in 2015, of all the counties in Tennessee, Davidson County was ranked as 87th worst for child well-being. The areas that we had our greatest challenges with were the areas of youth unemployment between the ages of 16 to 19, and also we had only 6.5% of children that were in poverty were actually receiving public health public benefits from Families First. Early child development is a key part of human development. It is the time when the most intricate parts of the brain begin to develop. It's also a time when toxic stress has a tendency to impair children in ways that it affects them throughout life and have lifelong consequences. In particular, children that are in poverty and low income are at greatest risk. This chart actually is a chart demonstrating the adverse childhood experiences, the impact, which lasts from birth through death in most cases. And children that are in poverty and low income have a higher risk. Actually, with Davidson County having approximately one-third of the minor children in poverty, it's also that they have a very good chance, or a bad chance, if you will, of actually experiencing adverse childhood experiences. The CDC has recommended particular family protective factors to safeguard our children. And those factors include things such as supportive family environments, child monitoring, stable relationships, caring adult role models, parenting skills, in addition to adequate housing, adequate employment for parents, and healthcare access. Based on the 2015 county health rankings from the Robert Wood Johnson's Foundation, we had some improvements in Davidson County, but we still have our challenges in comparison to the rest of Tennessee. And we did well in the areas of health benefits, where we were sixth. In clinical care, we were 17th. Our challenges still continue to be social and economic factors, where we were ranked as 44th and ranked as 77th in physical environment. In the physical environment, of course, we know traffic is an issue, and traffic continues to be one of the big factors in physical environment. In our social and economic areas, also, we have challenges. But one thing I also want to mention is that improvements in all of these areas are very important, and especially to those children and families that are in poverty and low-income families. Low-income children and families are more prone to have toxic environmental issues in their environment. In the state, or in the country, Tennessee, you can probably not even say that, but Tennessee was ranked as 43rd overall in all the nation as far as health. We were 43rd out of all the states in the nation. And this is according to the 2015 America's Health Rankings. And this is important because the health challenges in Tennessee continue to be some of those we've kind of dealt with over the years, which is obesity, inactivity, smoking, drug deaths, low birth weights, and violent crimes. Violence is an issue. Violence is a reality. It's not only affecting us here in Davidson County, as we well know, it's affecting our children, our families, our household, our workplaces. It's a factor that has become a major issue, and one that is involving a lot of premature deaths. It's a familiar course of action that people are deciding that they'll deal with their conflict in a violent way. It's a result of conflict, emotional distress, and of course, in criminal activity. Nearly 40% of the youth that are involved have experienced violence, have also had post-traumatic stress disorder symptoms. I'm going to quickly go through this because this is also important. We're being affected by drug abuse and deaths related to drug overdoses. Many people have died from drug overdoses in Tennessee, more than motor vehicles, homicides, or suicides. Opioid-prescribed medications just last year became the drug of choice over alcohol in Tennessee and in the United States. With increased enforcement of opioid-prescribed medications, we are now seeing an increase of heroin use and abuse. Finally, in closing, and just to join with my colleagues, it's all interrelated. You cannot see all of these factors, but it's very important that we address all the issues that affect people, that affect health and human development. I also encourage you, as you look through the community needs evaluation, to also check out the evidence-based practices related to health and human development. Thank you. I'd like to introduce at this time my colleague, Lee Stewart. Thank you.
I'm Lee Stewart. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about housing today and the housing crisis we have. And you want me to say, what housing crisis do we have? Oh, sorry. We had a lot, thousands of building permits drawn in 2014. And if you look around the city, you see cranes everywhere, right? Big holes in the ground. These are not affordable units. These are high-end units or possibly middle high-end units. We have a lot of people moving into Davidson County, so I'm sure you've read. In-migration has been more than the natural increase we would expect since 2010. In fact, in 2008, 30% of the people, young adults, 30% of the people moving in are young adults. Young adults that are coming in and young adults that are here are renting. That's the red line. And renting goes up and up and up. We do have some younger people who are homeowners. And now I'm going to talk about measuring some local opinion about needs. And this slide is like a hint. We do a front desk survey. We ask all the people who come into Metro Social Services to check off all the boxes they need to. What do you need? And since 2013, approximately 85% of the people coming in have checked the housing and related expense box. Just over half of those people have checked other boxes because there are a lot of folks in need who have multiple needs. But that also means that almost half of the people came in asking only for help with housing. Whoops. Dinah's told you about the grassroots survey, and one of the questions is, what are the greatest gaps? What do you feel are the greatest gaps between what we have and what we need? Housing and jobs. Jobs and housing. Always, always on the top. Food and health care are on the second tier usually. When you look at the question that just deals with housing, it says, what do we need in the area of housing? What do you think we need in the area of housing? Help paying bills and rent, and help paying rent, which is not going to be a big surprise to anybody in this room. Vacancy rate in the red is going down, 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 down. That means we have fewer vacancies. We have fewer places for people to rent. As apartments that used to rent for $700 now can be rented for $1,000, we have more and more people who are cost burdened. They spend more than a third of their income for housing, some of them up to 50%. As you see this, if you spend a third for housing, well, you gotta have some other stuff. You gotta have food, you gotta get back and forth to work, there's always sickness. Doesn't leave very much for the other stuff, as Julius had mentioned. The red line is renters in Davidson County earning less than $20,000. The blue line is owners earning rent less than $20,000. The owner line has a lot of seniors and people with disabilities living on fixed income. They may own their house, but they can't afford the upkeep. And some of the renters are seniors and others who have become renters because they want to get out from under those costs. If you want to see an interesting thing, look up paycheck to paycheck. Just Google paycheck to paycheck. They have a database. And you can go in there and you can put in an area and you can pick from a whole series of jobs. And it will show you what the median area costs are and the median area wages for particular occupations. And some of the occupations that are absolutely necessary to our growing economy. I mean, look at all the hotels and the tourist industry. So hotel housekeepers, childcare workers, cashiers, wait staff, none of those people can afford to rent even a one-bed apartment without being cost-burdened. And if you remember the big dollar sign, the more you're cost-burdened, the less you have for other things. The worst housing is no housing. We're doing better, like the rest of the country, in housing veterans, primarily because there's an agreement with Veterans Administration and HUD to provide more housing choice vouchers for veterans. Like the rest of the country, we need to work a little harder on family homelessness. And this shows that the trend line shows that homelessness is going up in Davidson County. But if you look at the numbers, it's about 200. It's within 200 from bottom to top. So we don't vary very much across the years. Like my section, like all the others, has some best practices, and the whole thing is full of links you can click on. There are some interesting things at the back of the housing. One of them is an inclusionary housing calculator. These people have developed a calculator that if you put in enough specific information about your town, your city, your neighborhood, it will calculate and tell you whether or not inclusionary zoning is a feasible thing to do, whether it's affordable, whether it's possible. And of course, the more information you put in, the more accurate it is. Personally, you might want to look at the Metro Property Assessor's map. It's an interactive map. You can put in your own address or outline a neighborhood or whatever, and it will give you a lot of information. So I encourage you to go to the full CNE online, look at all the maps, look at all the pretty charts, and click on all the links that interest you. Thank you. And Dinah's now going to cover workforce.
I will attempt to cover workforce. Alvin Gondibare would normally do this. He has had to be out of the country on some family business. But fortunate for you, a little bit later, we have a panel of real experts on workforce issues. So I'm looking forward to that. There was something I wanted to say about poverty. Y'all can't see, but we have somebody down here waving a stop sign, telling us to stop. And so I didn't get to say a couple things about poverty. One is, have you ever wondered why we have a generational cycle of poverty that doesn't seem to be able to be broken? The information that we talked about in terms of the adverse experiences, the toxic stress and so forth, contribute to that. And that's why we need specific, whether it's toxic trauma-informed care or whatever, it's important to address. But that helps explain generational poverty. Now, in terms of workforce, you see the crane. There's a lot of building going on throughout Davidson County. And a part of that contributed to the low unemployment rate. And as you can see, the unemployment rate has fluctuated over the years. It was highest during around the time and after the recession. And it is now, you can't see it, but in December it was down to 4%, which sounds good. In fact, it's lower than what's considered the natural unemployment rate of 5%, which, you know, if it's at that rate, everything's good. Ours is lower. The problem is that the people in Tennessee and in Davidson County don't make enough to support the high cost of living, in particular in Nashville. We have a lot of people making minimum wage jobs. Tennessee is one of the states that has chosen not to raise the minimum wage, so people make very little in many cases. In addition, there is a great disparity across racial and ethnic lines, as well as by other characteristics. As you can see, and this repeats the pattern that I talked about in poverty as far as unemployment, that you see that in terms of unemployment rate, the African Americans had the highest unemployment rate of 12.5 in 2014, again, the latest data. And you can see that's three times as much as the white population, with Hispanics in between. You can't say, but take my word for it. The black or African American unemployment was three times that of the white population. Okay, this gets also back to education. And the people who were unemployed, it's also very much related to the level of education that a person has. If a person has a bachelor's degree compared to a person who did not have a high school degree, high school diploma, it's four times as much for the people who didn't graduate from high school. It's very difficult for people with disabilities, in many cases, to obtain and maintain employment. They're very good workers. There's no reason a lot of times for this, and in fact, we have the ADA to protect them. However, if a person has a disability, they are more likely to be unemployed. And you can see that the unemployment rate for people with disabilities is 14.8, well over twice as much as those with no disability, which is 5.6. But the highest unemployment of all is with the youth. The people 16 to 19 years old is over 30%. And this is the time when young people should be learning skills that they carry forward through their career. But many of them cannot find jobs. The 20 to 24 age group, which is still considered youth, is still very high, 16.3%. Compared, when you look at the overall population, 16 and over, the unemployment rate was 6.4. So there's a huge difference between the youth and people who, like me, are not youth anymore. This shows unemployment geographically. It shows the disparity across the county. The areas in red have more than 10% unemployment, which is more than twice as much as the average for Davidson County. This chart is in your book and online, and it shows a list of occupations, and it shows the real change in their wage between 2009 and 2014. And real change incorporates factors such as inflation, and we all know inflation continues. So what it shows in particular, the people in red, many of these are service industries, like in hospitality and so forth. They've had real decreases. Their pay may be the same, but the value is much less, all the way up to 7% during that period. And the last thing is, there are many people, millions of people in the United States lifted out of poverty. Food stamps lifted the highest number out, followed by SSI, then housing assistance and unemployment. So if it weren't for this, these people would be in poverty, and they would suffer the same effects that I discussed in terms of toxic stress and adverse childhood experiences. Metro Social Service is, most of it is a direct service program, different kinds of services. And I'm going to introduce Lonnie Wade, who is the program manager in the Family Services Program. Planning and coordination is what you see on stage, plus outgoing. Many more people work in direct services, so I'd like to turn this over to Lonnie Wade.
Services at Social Services. That's our lovely building. And I just wanted to echo the sentiments of what was already said. So we know that if you don't have a job or you're not able to work, that affects your ability to have housing, right? And if you don't have housing, then for food, it's also going to be affected as well, because you may not have a place to store your food. Access to food may be in the form of, you know, fast food and things like that, right? And if I don't have food, then clearly my health can be affected. And if my health is affected, then back full circle, it may affect, you know, my ability to work. So I just wanted to say again that it truly is all around. For social services, pretty much our mission statement is there. What we believe and what we try to do, social services assesses and documents the patterns of poverty and seeks solutions that promote a positive impact on the most vulnerable people in Davidson County. You see also pretty much what we value, commitment to excellence, community focus, and compassion. So who do we serve? In a nutshell, social services serves individuals who are residents of Davidson County. Those individuals can be people who are in need, individuals who may be seeking information. But if you're a resident of Davidson County, that is who we serve. Customers can come to us by referrals, via fax, phone calls, emails, walk-ins, and appointments. So what do? Information and resources, case management, life management skills courses, senior nutrition, burial services, and planning, coordination, and social data analysis. So information and referral is basically just as it sounds. Individuals may come to our office, speak with one of the intake workers or a social worker, and basically get an assessment. Once they do that assessment, that social worker will then direct them to the appropriate resources that will help them meet that need that they have presented to that social worker or that intake worker. So case management. When we think of case management, we might see this guy right here, and you think of somebody who might be overworked. Pretty much throughout the Davidson County, a lot of the caseworkers, you know, may feel like this. But what I want to present to you is pretty much a very functional definition for case management, and it's basically going to be an ongoing collaborative process for planning, assessing, coordinating, advocating, as well as completing services. All that is done with the end in mind of helping that individual customer meet whatever need they have presented to that social worker. We also have coming soon life management skills courses. And what this is a group of classes that individuals can take that will foster and promote definitely life management skills. We find often that adults are sometimes not well equipped with some of the things that we take for granted on a daily basis, i.e. conflict resolution skills that may help me maintain my job because I was able to hold my tongue instead of cussing out my boss, right? Or time management skills where I can, you know, make sure that I plan ahead if I'm going to be late or if I have children and I have to get to work as well. You know, those type of things that can help us. So that's something that's actually going to be coming soon. And then our senior nutrition program. So this program is for seniors who are in Davidson County, obviously. Basically, they may have a need for food. So some of the customers in this program may not have access to adequate food, as was mentioned in our presentation that Julius did. It may also be an individual who may have access to, you know, food stamps, but it's not enough to carry them over. So they may apply for this program. Basically, the program is administered to individuals. They do two services. They do a home-delivered meals, which we have van drivers who go out and deliver meals pretty much 5 days a week to those individuals. And then we also have senior nutrition sites that are set up for individuals to actually come and congregate. Those senior nutrition sites make it very possible for those seniors to actually keep and lock themselves into their community and remain independent. And that's 14 of the different sites that they have throughout the community of Davidson County. We also have an indigent burial program. That program is for individuals who do not have funds left to go towards their final arrangements. So our program, if they're eligible, will actually pay for their burial or their cremation. And anyone who can apply basically would be a family member first and foremost. If a family member is not available, then a friend or an agency representative can apply for that person. Just some different services that we also have. Community locations, we recognize that Davidson County is large, so we have stationed out different community locations that we send social workers to throughout the week as well. Other programs and partners that we collaborate with, different programs that we also partner with as well. And then the best way to get in contact with us is this information. If you want to contact us for any of those services, that's our contact information. And that is my presentation.
Thank you, Lonnie. Mayor Berry was elected on September 19, 2015, and she serves as our seventh mayor of Metropolitan Government of Nashville and Davidson County. Mayor Berry has demonstrated her interest in issues that affect Davidson County residents in need. Her interest in promoting prosperity for all parts of Davidson County is clear, and we look forward to continuing to work with her to provide opportunity for those in Davidson County. Please join me in welcoming our history-making mayor, Mayor Megan Berry.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's such a pleasure to be here. And so I'm going to try that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, you guys are awesome. You know, recently I was out of town and I was up north and I did that and all I got was crickets. And so I had to explain to them, hey, I'm from the South. We do call and response. So you guys already know how to do it. It's all good. I want to take a minute and just recognize some of the other elected officials who are joining us today. We have, of course, Howard Gentry in the back, our clerk back there. Howard told me a minute ago that he was acting as the doorstop to keep the air flowing. So, Howard, you are a man of all trades. We really appreciate it. We also have Councilmember Freddie O'Connell here. Councilmember Nancy Van Reese is here, over here. Councilmember Mina Johnson is here.
Councilmember Berkeley Allen is here, and Councilmember Berkeley Allen is my councilmember. And of course, you always have to ask, did I leave anybody out? Okay, good, because that's always the danger. I want to say thank you to those Metro Council members who are here. I think it shows a real commitment to the conversation that we're having today and the importance of this to our community. I also want to thank Renee. You know, Renee and I have had the opportunity to serve with each other on the Homelessness Commission for the last several years, and I know how hard Renee works, and I know how deeply she cares about our community and about these issues. And her team is amazing. They get up every day and embody what I believe is the spirit of Nashville, the spirit of wanting to make our community a better place. I have a quote in my office that says, power is about waking up every day and making a difference in somebody else's life. And the fact that I get to sit in this seat for this amount, short time, gives me a little bit of power to do exactly that. And I know that all of you in this room wake up and think the same thing. You have the ability to make a difference in somebody's life every day, and I am grateful and thankful that you take your energy and your time to do just that. So today, we're talking about poverty. We're talking about what our community still has to do so that we go from just being the it city to the city that gets it. So let me just take a few minutes to talk about what I see. I believe that we have to address this head on. We can't ignore it, we can't downplay it, we can't just ignore the fact that with Nashville's all of our success, that we don't also have opportunities and challenges. It's how we address it. Now's the time. We have to make sure that all of our citizens share in our prosperity. And right now, if you look at this report, our numbers are trending in the wrong direction. We have a strong economy. We have a lot of things going for our community. And if you look across the United States at other places where you have those strong economies, their poverty numbers are trending down. So ours is going in the wrong direction, and I want to see us go in the right direction. I'm really thankful for all of the things that planning, coordinating, and the social data and analysis has done to collect all of this and put this into this report, because I really believe that if you don't have data, you don't know how to get your arms around something. You don't know how to address it. You don't know where to put the focus, the money, to get the best outcome, so I appreciate that. And I think a lot of times, this really does tell a Nashville story, and it gets lost. This report shows that we have a lot of work to do. You may have seen recently in the news that my office announced a workforce development initiative to train jobs for workers for our construction industry. The construction industry actually has a lot of really great jobs. We want contractors to be able to work here in Davidson County. In fact, the voters, 58% of them, said that that's what they wanted to. So my office said, the will of the voters, we need to take that on, and we need to figure out how to do it. And I think we've put together a really good approach to make sure that we will have the capacity and the training needed to make that happen. And I know that Paul Haynes is here and Ellen is here, and I think you're gonna hear a workforce plan here in a few minutes, so I'm not gonna steal their thunder. But I will tell you that the state took an action earlier this week to overturn the voters' will. The state gets to do that. But what I believe is what our folks were telling us is that we have a problem that we need to solve. And when we look at our unemployment rate, we can say that it's at 4%, but when we look at it from a broader perspective, and we look at that 18 to 24-year-old African-American males, it's tremendously higher. So how are we going to make sure we impact that? I believe that you connect people to hope by connecting them to jobs, and we're focused on that. So ultimately, I believe that's what the voters asked me to do. So we've got workforce development happening in the mayor's office. We also have a focus on affordable housing and trying to connect people to housing options that are in the price point where they can afford. Whether it's putting folks who are unhoused into housing, providing housing for low income, providing that workforce housing that's so important, but it's also about making sure that we keep people in their houses as well. We recently are having a conversation about inclusionary zoning, and that's advancing through the Metro Council right now. They're having that conversation We've gone ahead and we're moving forward on laying a lot of groundwork with the Barnes Fund. We want the Barnes Fund to be a focus on how we can create more affordable housing. We just took Metro properties that were owned by Metro. We have 13 surplus properties, and we're working with the not-for-profit development community to create affordable housing on those properties. I believe that the mayor's office, my role is to be the convener, to bring all of the parties together so that we can create a city that we can all be proud of. Government can't do it alone, though. That's why it's so important to have all the partners who are here today to help us address this very important issue. I've also spent a lot of time in the last 5 months talking about youth violence, and I can't walk off the stage without just mentioning it, because it's really close to my heart, and it's something that I want to see us make significant strides in the next year. In fact, we just had a shooting this morning. A 16-year-old had access to a firearm and shot his grandmother and his brother and his sister. And you know what? That kind of news anymore just rolls off of people's backs. In fact, I was somewhere the other night where a gentleman was saying that he was talking to a group of folks about a mass shooting that had happened recently, that earlier that day, and they actually asked him which one, because there were five across the United States that he could choose from. And so when I think about how we connect youth to hope, I also believe that's about giving them opportunities. We brought together 400 public high school students recently at Rockettown to ask them specifically to talk about what they need from the adults in the room. We didn't talk at them, they talked to each other. And the one comment that was the most powerful for me came from a gentleman whose name was Brandon. And Brandon said, you know, as adults, you ask us to walk a tightrope. We have to be perfect. We have to do a lot of things, but you don't give us a safety net. And we need that safety net. And that's what the citizens of Davidson County need. They need a safety net when they fall, be they youth, be they folks who have fallen on hard times. And I believe that is the role of what we do as a government, to provide that safety net. As we move forward with our youth engagement, my challenge to our community is going to be to put 10,000 youths to work. Other cities do it. We can do it. We are focused on that, and I know you all in this room are going to help me make it happen. Because at the end of the day, as I said before, you can't do it alone. I'll leave you with this before I turn it over to the panel. The one thing I love about Nashville is just sometimes how honest people are. So a couple of times recently, I've had folks walk up to me and say, you know, you weren't my first choice. But they say, I want you to be successful. Because if you're successful, Nashville's successful. And I need all of you in this room to make Nashville successful. So I thank you for all you do. I thank you, Renee, especially, for all the hard work your team does. And if there's ever anything I can do for you, please let me know, but call Renee first. Thank you.
Take a 10-minute break and come back with our panel. Thank you.
The technical issues that we've had, but we hope everything turns out. The good thing is you have everything that we've said so far pretty much is in your books and online. So it is, the information is there, and we know people are not going to remember hearing it just one time. As we mentioned earlier, the two big issues continue to be affordable housing and workforce and economic opportunity. At last year's event, we did an expert panel on affordable housing. This year, we're doing one on workforce and economic opportunity. And Paul Haynes, the director of the Nashville Career Advancement Center, will serve as the moderator. The people who are on the panel include Betty Johnson from Goodwill Industries, who also serves as a member, who has been a member of our board of social services, and is Stephanie Harris from the Nashville Workforce Development Program at JUMP, Ellen Zinkowitz, who is also with the Nashville Career Advancement Center, Betty Kirkland from Project Reflect, Project Return, Ashford Hughes from the mayor's office, and we have a consumer also. We have a consumer with us to provide us a unique perspective on the issues related to workforce and economic opportunities. His name is Kevin Ball. So with that, I'm going to turn this over to Paul Haynes.
Thank you, Diane, and I will say I'm glad we don't have a PowerPoint presentation. So, and thanks to the good work of the staff here, the microphones we checked and do work up front, so they will not be yelling at you throughout this presentation. I'm Paul Haynes. I'm the executive director of the Nashville Career Advancement Center and the Middle Tennessee Workforce Board. We are a publicly funded agency, mostly federally funded, and we operate in a four-county area. For those of you in here who ever have been to a career center, our organization is one of those that runs career centers. We also run a lot of youth programs, and Ellen Zinkwitz on the panel, who is our youth expert. And I wanted to kind of frame the panel out like this so you guys kind of get an idea what you've got. Betty Kirkland, Project Return, Offender Reentry Programs, very active in the community, but specializing basically in that particular area, has in her past life was an attorney. I guess once an attorney, always an attorney, but has been an attorney. Ellen Zinkowitz next to her is our Director of Youth Services, Master Degree Social Worker, been doing this about 16, 17 years. I know she doesn't look it, but you know, kind of a youth thing, it kind of worked for her, 40 under 40, all that stuff. Betty Johnson, next to her, as you heard, she is on the Metro Social Services Board. She's also on the Middle Tennessee Workforce Board. She's also served a stint on the State Workforce Investment Board with Goodwill Industries, the VP, and has been one of the leaders, in fact, the kind of centerpiece leader of the Nashville Workforce Network as we've gone through, which has been was an offshoot of the Poverty Initiative back in 2007. The Nashville Workforce Network kind of created around that. And now we're, 9 years into it afterwards, and we've got over 100 organizations and 46 government entities and employers and so on. Next are Ashford Hughes, you heard about. Ashford is the Director for Workforce Development out of the Mayor's office. Ashford and the Mayor have been really leading a charge to try to address workforce issues in our city. As somebody who's been doing this quite a long time, seeing the energy of Mayor Berry and not only her energy, but putting her money where her mouth is and the things that she wants to do to move things forward has been very exciting to a workforce development guy. Ashford has been leading those charges. Stephanie next to him has worked in the, make sure I get this right, because it's recently changed names, so I want to make sure she sent it to me, with the Metro Nashville Workforce Development Program at JUMP, which is, she's the Director of Workforce Development. When the Convention Center was built, they were highly involved in trying to engage community individuals into the work in the convention center and the construction of it. And then Kevin Ball, who's a customer. So you're going to hear from those. And what I want to do is, as you looked at all the presentations and you heard everything, did everybody get the sense there's a direct correlation between poverty and unemployment, between housing issues and unemployment? Those are the things, I mean, it's natural. Everybody in the room knows, as we all say, a good job will fix a lot of ills. We all know that to be true. But then when you look into the meat of the data, you start to look at the youth numbers that are astronomical, people with disabilities and how their numbers are. So what I want to do is kind of throw it out to the panel, and we'll start at the end with Betty. Around you, when you look at those high unemployment numbers, in this case, particularly around the offender population, can you tell us some best practices or some things that you know of that are going on to address that issue here?
Sure, thank you very much. As we know, mass incarceration is a defining dilemma of our time, and Project Return works in that arena. So when we talk about unemployment, those numbers would be vastly larger if we included in our definition of unemployment people who were away from home and incarcerated. Those just exacerbate those unemployment numbers if we look at it that way. And not only that, but because of the racial disparities inherent in our current criminal justice system, it blows up that disproportionate impact. More on that later. But to answer the question, we do have several things that we feel work especially well for the folks that we serve and the work that we do, with about 400 to 500 people a year coming out of prison, coming to Project Return. As a workforce development innovator, the first thing that we think works is specialization. So we specialize on this population. We don't look at a general hard-to-employ mass, but rather to look at the people with the particular issues that we have developed our offender workforce development specialty around. A second strategy is what I call trans-employment, which is to say transitional jobs initiatives. This is something that we're in our third year of at Project Return, and it is specifically to give people a post-prison employment opportunity so that they can move on from that to an employer who may be reluctant to hire them, but with a little bit of experience in the workforce, few weeks of workforce experience, they're much more appealing to the employer. The third thing is to be in relationship. Nothing we do works if we're not in relationship with the employers, businesses, government, and especially the people that we serve. The fourth thing is just to wrap around with services. A hungry job seeker is not a terribly effective job seeker. So when we talk about food, we gotta get them food. We gotta get clothing, we gotta get all those things lined up. People getting out of prison in Tennessee don't have IDs, so it's a whole wraparound service. If I may, for the individuals, we tell them to go in person and sell yourself. We tell them to be forthright and honest about themselves. We tell them to let their soft skills show. Let those employers have a vision of what it would be to choose to hire that good person. Lastly, to plan and reorient themselves all the time and to seek encouragement. We're here to encourage, and a lot of people are there to encourage, and we ask them to look for that. Overarchingly, and I'm stealing this line from someone who was at our office this weekend who is an entrepreneur, he said, outwork your problems. And so we say, for ourselves as workforce developers and for our clientele as motivated job seekers, outwork that past, outwork that stigma, outwork that other job seeker that doesn't have a criminal background. Work the job search and work the job readiness and make those opportunities work for you.
Thank you. I want to add a couple of things. Just Betty brought up something that is very important. For those of you who aren't necessarily in the workforce arena or don't deal with unemployment statistics and rates very much, Betty said something that is very true, that is something that we all need to look at, is the unemployment rate is not a true reflection of those who are looking for work. It is those who are in the workforce, those who have been laid off out of the workforce, currently drawing unemployment insurance, and those who have shown up at a government facility or setting and registered to work. Those are the people getting. So we know there's a lot of people who are underemployed or looking for work that don't show up in that number. The offender population is just one example of that. Then we've got youth. And we heard the large number of, I think I did the math, if the math worked right, 16 to 24, 36.2% of youth 16 to 24 are out of work. So that is a huge population and something that we should be addressing. And I want to let Ellen talk about a few things. Ellen?
So young people, when young people are looking for employment, they do that in some of the same ways that grown-ups do. And a lot of it is around who do you know. So if you are one of those young people who knows people who are largely unemployed because that's the community in which you live, or for whom you're in direct competition for the jobs that are available in your community and that people know about with other unskilled individuals, a young person who has never worked before is very likely to lose out in that competition. It's a rough thing to be somebody's first boss. There are a lot of first-timer mistakes, and I'm not going to ask the room, because I'm sure all of you are now thinking about the first things that you did in your first jobs and how you were really grateful that you were no longer in your first jobs and don't have to make those mistakes again. That can be a tough first experience for young people. So the first is, in terms of best practices in working with these young people, the first is continuing to wrap around them the supports of discernment. So what do you want to be when you grow up? And oftentimes with young people too, you think, all right, I know a lot of jobs that are available, but most of the jobs that were available are the ones that we see. There are an awful lot of jobs that aren't pictured on television. And that the people next to us, if we really only know people who work in schools or who work in service jobs, are doing. And we need to give our young people more of an opportunity to learn about what is available to them. What kinds of jobs could they do? Then we need to support them with how to get there. I love what Betty said about the wraparound supports. A hungry job seeker is not an effective job seeker. An unsupported job seeker may simply need some additional support. But finally, with young people, too, and one of the things that we're moving towards, and I want to give a shout out to Metro Action for doing the same thing, and to Goodwill for very similar kinds of models, is a high school diploma is not enough anymore. And first of all, a lot of our young people, 16 to 24, age-appropriate wise, 16, 17, 18-year-olds may not have their high school diploma to start with. But also, many of the jobs that lead to self-sufficient wages, that lead to the kind of income that would allow you to get a start in the economy, that would lead you to potentially having a career or a long-term vision, those aren't jobs that you can step into with ease right out of high school. You need additional skills. And our young people very often, while we have made tremendous strides with our high school graduation rate, but very often our young people simply don't know what the possibilities are and do not know the providers or purveyors of the skilled training that would help them get to those hidden possibilities. So, as I mentioned, Metro Action is starting with their Parents of Head Start children, a CompTIA program that leads to certification in an IT field. Goodwill has a variety of different certification programs. I know that's something Project Return has also looked at, and JUMP too, where we're looking at hard skills. How do we get people the skill set that employers are looking for? And how do we do that in a wrapped around sort of way so that people have the support, especially young people who are making those first goofball mistakes because they're in their first jobs? How do we give them that support, the exposure, and then the skills to successfully move into self-sufficient wages?
Thanks, Ellen. I think that if you take it back to what the mayor said, and almost the challenge the mayor gave everybody, 10,000 youth at work, that's what you're hearing. We've got to help youth go to work. So Goodwill. Goodwill trains a lot of different targeted populations, but what kind of caught my eye a lot with the numbers around people with disabilities. Can you talk a little bit about that and some of the work you're doing?
I will. Thank you, Paul, and hello, everybody. I've been with Goodwill 23 years, and we've gone through a great metamorphosis. Our Goodwill is not just Davidson County. We're in Middle Tennessee and West Tennessee. So I've got 29 career centers out there helping people who are unemployed connect with job training and jobs. Last year, we helped over 15,000 people connect with jobs, and that's great. Where we like to focus on and where we originated back in 1957 when we came to Nashville was helping folks with disabilities. We started then with contracts with the state government, local government, to serve just people with disabilities and give them job training and access to jobs and to employ them at Goodwill. You know that I've got over 2,000 employees in our Goodwill at those stores, and you know when you donate, the people who accept your donations, and those people in our plant sorting stuff. But we went away from that in the early 90s when the funding went away and we opened our doors to anybody who needed our service to connect with jobs, anybody who was in poverty, anybody who was unemployed, anybody who had a barrier to employment, criminal background, lack of a high school education, lack of literacy, person with disability, any of that. Where we have come back to is a special focus on serving and helping to employ people with more severe disabilities. In 2007, our board of directors decided we needed to make extra effort and add extra funding to the effort of reaching out to find people with more severe disabilities and to connect with them individually, one-on-one, in a case management situation. We would provide the assessment services, the intake services, stuff we all do, but with this population so that we could find out what their specific needs were, what their barriers are. Sometimes it's transportation. Somebody in a wheelchair may not have access to transportation, may not be able to get on the bus line like everybody else can, or they may not have somebody be able to drive them. Some people who have disabilities may have more medical appointments. They may need to go in for dialysis 3 times a week. So there's a scheduling barrier there. Some folks may not know what it is to work. Some people are born with a disability, but some people may have something happen in their lives where they then have a disability. This becomes a barrier, and they have to relearn everything. At Goodwill, we have case managers, we have job coaches, we have job developers, so that we are working individually with over, I think it was 800 people last year, and we helped over 500 of them connect with jobs. A few of them at Goodwill, but we're finding more and more employers, as we meet with those employers, are opening up their doors to understand that just because somebody has a physical or a mental challenge doesn't mean there isn't something at their company that the person can do. And our folks work with those employers to really outline, maybe even carve out job tasks, so that folks with more severe disabilities can work at employers who maybe previously weren't thought of before. It's interesting. When you talk about an accommodation, it doesn't mean you change your entire work life. No, you may change how some piece of the work is done. And I think we've become the experts in helping employers understand how they can do that so that more and more people with disabilities can become employed. One other barrier folks have when they have a more severe disability is that they have a limited amount of income they can make. So that alters their schedule, that alters their dollars per hour. So we have to be creative when talking to those employers to say, maybe part-time's okay. If this person can function for you, can be productive for you, we can make a minor accommodation and work around their schedule. That's a lot. But we've done it, and we do it well with folks who have more severe disabilities. So I'm proud to say that I do work for Goodwill, and we're here to serve anybody who's unemployed or in poverty to connect them with the job training programs we have and with the employers.
Thanks, Betty. I'm going to switch it up a little bit because I want to let you guys talk about service. Then I want to circle back over to Ashford and then come back to Cabot. So, Stephanie, when you looked at a lot of the numbers that were up there, particularly around the minority community, about the unemployment rates and their poverty rates being much higher than white, can you talk a little bit about some of the initiatives that JUMP or you've been engaged with trying to address some of that inequity?
Absolutely. One of the things that we have at Metro Nashville Workforce have discovered is that there are so many barriers to employment for people in our community. There are things that I had no idea of when I started working. And when I started working, it was JUMP. And so you will catch me saying that, you know, now and then, but it is Metro Nashville Workforce Development Program at JUMP because we had to separate. However, there are so many barriers. It used to be that if you had a driver license offense that you would lose your license because of that, the court costs relative to that offense. However, now if you receive any court costs at all that are unpaid within a year, you lose your driver's license. Oftentimes you lose your driver license for child support. Now when someone goes to jail and they come out of jail or prison, their license is already gone because the court costs, time to pay those court costs has expired. So they're coming out with jail fees, they're coming out with fine, with court costs, and they're coming out without a driver's license. And there are so many jobs that you can get if you have a driver's license, even with a criminal background. But one of the other barriers, because that is not always the case, it's very disconcerting to know that there are federal bonding programs that will bond an employee that has a criminal background, and there are tax incentives that employers can be offered in order to hire convicted felons. However, insurance companies preclude these companies from hiring a lot of these felons. I've contacted, as we've all mentioned, relationships are very, very important. And so I've contacted Grayline, I've contacted any number of places to see, okay, well, I've got somebody, their felony is 16 years old. He's got a CDL, and we help people get their driver's license back. So sometimes we'll get a newly licensed person, and I'll call some of my contacts. Sometimes they can help, and sometimes they can't, depending on what their criminal background is. But there are so very many barriers. They come out and they don't necessarily know how to use a computer. And online job applications are 99% of the applications these days. So we put in a computer lab, and if they schedule an appointment, we can sit there with them and go line by line with their applications. Now, we are tiny, a tiny little office. There are three of us in workforce development. And so we're very excited about the mayor's workforce development initiative because that's 10,000 kids and 10,000 people that have not previously been employed that we're looking to get employed. But what we try to do is to be the catch-all. When they make those first-time mistakes on the job, we ask Express, who's here, Temp Service, we ask them, when they make that mistake, send them to us. Let us clean them up. Let us tell them where their mistake was, and then perhaps they can keep that next job. And so in our small office, those are the type, we try to catch the people that fall through the cracks, try to help them get their driver's license back, try to get their voting rights back, because when they come out of prison, they're either on probation or parole 99% of the time, but they're expected to pay taxes, but they have no say-so as to where their tax money goes. And it gives, it leads to this feeling of, you know, there's nothing I can do. I can't get a job because I'm a felon. I can't get a job because every time I get in the car and drive myself to an interview, I get arrested. You know, I can't get a job, you know, I'm paying money, but everything is against me because I have no say-so as to what is happening in my world. And, you know, yesterday I've got just a really feel-good story to you all to appreciate. This man walks in the office. He was released from prison on February 5th. Been incarcerated for 34 years. He pulled out his phone. He was like, I don't even know how to answer it. And, you know, so we took a few minutes to show him how to, you know, the basic functions of his phone. So when he gets a call from an employer, he knows how to answer the phone. The other good news is one of my people that owns a private construction company called and said, somebody just called in sick. Do you have anybody for me? We drove him to that construction site because that person was willing to hire him. And so when I checked on him at the end of the day, he said, when I checked with the employer, he said, Stephanie, the world is moving a little fast for him. He said, but he's got a good attitude and I'm keeping him. And so that's the kind of thing that JUMP does, Metro Nashville Workforce does, within the mayor's office and with the mayor's programs, we hope to catch some of the people that would walk into NCAC that you may not be able to get employed. You can send them to us and we would be able to clean them up and help them get a driver's license where they are able to drive legally. We know they can get to work because there are also many places, employers, that cannot hire people if they don't have a driver's license, even if a driver's license is not required on their job, because the employers are trying to be sure that these people can get back and forth to work. We started a banquet service training program, hopeful that with the industry in Nashville being what it was, that we would really be able to get a lot of people employed. Well, in order to be a banquet server, which most of us would think is a pretty entry-level position, you have to get an ABC card. ABC, the Alcoholic Beverage Commission, because you might hold a glass that once had champagne in it. And a lot of felons are not eligible to get ABC cards. So we are here to address many of the barriers that keep people from being employed and to try to maintain relationships that then will encourage people to take, companies to take our applicants on a case-by-case basis. We work very closely with the Omni. We were also on site there. We were on site at the HCA job site at 11th and Charlotte. And we are having some success with getting people to take our applicants on a case-by-case basis. And what I'd ask from you all is when you are at the voting booth to take into consideration some of these barriers that we might have thought was a good idea. Well, surely a child at 16 is going to go to school if they know that they can't get a driver's license if they don't go to school. Well, that child, if they're not going to school, they have a bigger problem than their driver's license already. And so they're starting off driving anyway because their parents need to get places. And then they start getting tickets, and then the next thing you know, they have thousands of dollars in court costs. And they're never going to be able to get their license. We have people that it's been 20 years since they've had them. So we are here to try to remove some of the barriers and try to take some of those 10,000 people that the mayor wants to get employed, and when they fall through the cracks, we want to catch them and put them right back out there before they lose hope. And that's what JUMP is doing. And did you want to take Kevin next?
I'm going to go to Ashford in just a second, because I want to kind of round this conversation out. When we looked at all the charts that were up there, these individuals kind of hit some of those populations that have high poverty, high unemployment. You heard from them kind of some of the initiatives and things they were doing. And, you know, we're in this field. We do this on a daily basis. So we see those people. And the story that Stephanie told, I mean, we can tell those stories about the people who are coming in. And you always look for where that shining star is and where that next thing is going to be that'll make it easier on folks. And you know, Mayor Berry has been a breath of fresh air and has brought Ashford in, so I just thought it'd be a good opportunity for Ashford to kind of roll that out and kind of talk about some of the things the mayor's envisioned.
All right, just one second. I wanted you all to know who Kevin is. Kevin came with me today because he came through our program. Kevin has a CDL and came to us having lost his CDL, and he will talk a little bit about the barriers that he personally faced and how he's been able to overcome those. And so again, when you are in decision-making, room to make a decision, or in a voting booth, that you make a decision and you think about people that can't be there, You think about the effect that whatever is in front of you might affect the people that are not making that decision, because a lot of times we don't think about the people except those of us here in this room when there are people that can't be in this room that our decisions really affect. And so Kevin will be talking a little bit about that once Ashford is finished.
Thank you. So as many of you know, and hopefully most of you voted for it back last year, we did pass in Nashville a ballot initiative that sought to make certain that a certain percentage of local residents had access to Metro-funded construction projects. Through that process, unfortunately, the state has overturned that ruling. During the whole time, we thought that this might happen, so we started to convene stakeholders on all sides of the equation, both contractors, union contractors, community, Mike Hodge with NOAA, and the mayor's office to see what can we do, irregardless of what the state does, to make certain that we're providing a portal and a much more connected pipeline for workers in our city to have access to training and then have access to actual job acquisition. So what we have right now with this project, we feel as though the Nashville Construction Partnership is something that we can continue to move forward in a positive manner. So it stands on a three-legged stool, so to speak. One of the first components of it is that we had to have a community partner. We had to have access to community groups to be able to pull in those workers that needed or could potentially work on construction jobs. One such organization as Al Line is a strong partner is Nashville Organized for Action and Hope, which is a, and I think I may be off, Mike, 51 member faith-based organizations, labor unions, as well as community organizations. Also with the Nashville Workforce Network, which is another large organization comprised of nonprofit entities in the community. So we wanted to make certain that we had access to community people that knew residents that needed training and access to these construction jobs. The second piece was a portal to really be able to connect a resident with whatever job skills they needed with the training and then connect them with employer. If you don't take anything away from what I'm gonna say today, take down this information. The website is jobs4tn.gov. Jobs4tn.gov. This is the great portal that right now we use across the state to connect and to match employers with employees and vice versa. This is going to be the tool that we use to work with Stephanie and her organization as we draw those people in and really put them to work. So the last component was really having the employer buy-in. If there's no employer buy-in at the end of this, then we're just doing training for the sake of doing trainings. So as we sat around and talked about this, it was important that the construction industry really, and some of the ties that bound us together was that the construction industry said they needed more workers and they would prefer to have more local workers because it saved them a cost of bringing in workers from out of state and out of county. So they have committed to actually being on that back end of hiring these individuals once we get them to a certain point through the training process. And that's using training in both labor organizations, apprenticeship programs, and non-labor union apprenticeship programs. So we feel this is just the first step, and right now it's just dealing with Metro-funded projects. So when we're not building a music city center or a sound stadium, we're talking about sidewalks, we're talking about water and sewer type infrastructure work going forward. We thought this was a very important issue that we want to put on the table. Did you want me to talk about other?
Anything youth particularly?
So the mayor has also set forward a few other quick initiatives, two of which I really want to point out. One is our veterans initiative. We have been working with the commissioner of the VA, Manny Barris Grinder, to start a community Nashville Serving Veterans community organization group. I believe Aaron, who is here today, I believe we have 20 to 30,000 veterans in Nashville, and we want to work to find ways that we give those that have fought and taken care of our country access to opportunities here in Davidson County. Another really important function is working with Jobs for TN and the Nashville Career Advancement Center. When we look at those poverty rates, we as a community, we as the mayor's office, have to put initiatives where the need is. So what we're talking about being able to do is to go to Tracy Henderson at Magruder Center and say, we have this portal that people can come in on Jobs for Tennessee, fill out an application, get some resume assistance. If you allow us to come in and train two people to come in here and work with you, we can go to Matthew Walker and do the same thing. But we know where the crime is right now. We know where the youth situations are occurring. We just need to put direct access to job opportunities right there. The second piece, I won't say the 10,000 that the mayor's talking about, but we want to amp up youth job opportunities right now. We've been working with Ellen and her office and other providers. He just left, but former council member at large, Ronnie Stein, is in our office now, kind of heading up that operation because it's a big operation. Finally, I'll talk about one other thing, is that we want to, first and foremost, really do an enhancement of what the city is doing right now in workforce development. So I've been kind of gathering all the information and all the organizations that are doing this, and eventually we're going to get into a room to make certain that we're all on the same page, moving down one path to achieve what we want to achieve in workforce development. I don't think in the past we've had a clear definition of all the organizations and what they're doing. So we want to do that so we can work more efficiently and send people to Goodwill, send them to Project Return, the Nashville Career Advancement Center, which is 665 Main Street Drive, two blocks from here, that everybody in this room should know about and start directing people towards. So that's just some of the initiatives right now that the mayor is going to be trying to push going forward.
Thanks, Ashford. And kind of sum all this up from a customer's perspective. So Kevin, if you would talk about a little bit about what you heard and about your background.
Stephanie basically said my story. Okay, I'm a veteran, United States Air Force veteran. I have a commercial driver's license. I wastewater management treatment over 30 years off and on construction. My dad owned a construction company. And these are just some of the small things that I would bring to the table, you know, as a prospective employer. But I'm a convicted felon. I'm over 50. You know, so that's a challenge right there within itself. Those two challenges within itself, you know, in the workforce is what seems to be now insurmountable. But you know, you go to work, you go to apply for these jobs, and you put your application in, and you tell these things, and you get the interview, and you're sitting in there, and or you get on the job, you get a chance to do the job, and you're out there with a workforce that's 20 years younger than you, no background, but you bringing it, you working every day, and you doing this, and when it comes time for, you know, for say this is a temporary thing, when it comes time for you to get for them to do the permanent hiring, you got so many barriers. Your license, you're trying to work to pay your license and get your license back, or you're trying to catch back up on child support, and it seems insurmountable sometimes, but you know the challenges are just so unnecessary. You know, that's the word I would use. I'm lost. I'm, you know, like, yeah. When I got arrested, I was working. I was working on the job. I got arrested I went home to help my dad. You know, basically die, and they arrested me and brought me back to Nashville. And I lost my license while in jail. Child support bill, you know, back and back up. I get out. I go into a veterans program. I get back in the workforce, you know, trying to get back in the workforce, and all these barriers are there, you know, and I find a place like Jump, and I'm nervous, huh? And I find a place like Jump. I go in there, and you know, it's some real tangible things going on. And while incarcerated, I went through the reentry program. I'm familiar with Project Return, so. These things are, you know, they're real, but what we need, what we as convicted felons, as, you know, people with jobs, we need society, we need the workforce to be more understanding of our challenges. You know, the programs are there. You know, we go through the programs, but then when we get out here and, you know, in life and go apply for these jobs, they don't give them. They don't give them to us. Whether it be for this or that, we don't get the jobs. Some of the things, like, you know, I want to go into the customer service industry. I can't get an ABC license because I'm a convicted felon. Let's say you got a guy that they got into a fight in the club. I'm not saying that that's right to get in, but that's the reality of it. Whether you're the aggressor or you're defending yourself, you got a felony conviction or an assault conviction on your record, and you no longer can work in the customer service industry. It's just so, the challenges are so various, you know, that it's.
Thanks, Kevin. You got anything else you want to add? Because we got 5 minutes. I was going to let the audience ask anything they wanted to ask.
We need more programs like Jump. I went in there one day about 10 o'clock, trying to get my license back. At 12 o'clock, I had my license. Wow. So, you know, it wasn't about their name flashing in license. It was about actually helping the client. And, you know, those are the programs that we need, you know, out in the community.
Thank you, Kevin. I think some of the things you said are, I love the workforce needs to be more understanding. We can put all the programs together in the world, but if you still can't get the ABC card or you can't get your driver's license back or whatever, then it the rest of the stuff really didn't matter because you can't. Thanks. Anybody have any questions? We had about 5 minutes, and I don't have anybody down here holding up a sign for me, so. Where is Jump located?
We are at 1215 9th Avenue North. And we ask that with our driver's license class, it's been overwhelming. Like I said, we're a tiny staff. So if you know of anyone, please go to our website at jumpnashville.com rather than call the office if you can avoid that. Our classes are held Wednesday at 3 and Fridays at 10. And I would like to add that we are one of the we get people ready to go to the public defender's office that can help them because they are unable to be helped if they have out of state or out of county. So we're one of the few agencies that help in that regard. But we are at 1215 9th Avenue North. The classes are Wednesday at 3, I'm sorry, and Fridays at 10.
And you said jumpnashville.com.
Jumpnashville.com.
Com, not got. Or. Okay, thank you. Yes, ma'am.
After listening to all this data and all this information that you guys have, has there ever been a thought about the feasibility when you're trying to get people into the workforce and there's all these challenges? I work out of the NGO Family Resource Center. I find resources to send people to. They do not have transportation to get there. They don't even have stuff like a bus fare to get on the bus. So what's the feasibility of putting all these different entities together, creating jobs for some of the people that need jobs, just doing transportation? You know this person over here in South Nashville needs to get to East Nashville. Somewhere in all these different agencies, is there a way to put a program together to employ drivers to pick up those people and get them back to work? Can y'all kind of just think about that?
Sure, thank you. Good question.
One of the ways that we have addressed it is to partner with a company that provides free bus passes. So if we have people that need transportation to an interview, or let's say that it's 2 weeks before they get their first paycheck, then we can give them 2 weeks worth of bus passes. And so we are very thankful to Advance Financial for providing that. And at this time, it's I hesitate to say unlimited, but thus far it has been. And so if you know people that need them, you're welcome to send them to our office. We'll keep them coming as long as we're able to get them. We've thought about that, and we know it's difficult, and we've been to Edge Hill, and we appreciate everything that you do. But
again, that driver's license is critical, because these hospitality jobs don't run when the buses run. And so you're exactly right. So we need to address the transportation.
I think that is how, the transportation issue from a workforce development standpoint, it's kind of like the job to poverty. When you start having a conversation about workforce development, transportation comes back into the mix every time, just trying to get people there. So it is something that is on everybody's radar. How do we do it? We've got time for one more question. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
I think that's happening right now. There's a stakeholder group that has formed over the last couple of months called Nashville's Agenda. And it's a lot of people that are participating in the Nashville Next process, business leaders, education leaders in the city. And my colleague Lionel Matthews, who isn't here, he was at a meeting maybe a month ago, and that approach was brought up about, and the mayor talks about this often, private-public partnerships. Because she believes, and she says put private first because we need more buy-in from the private industry now. But some of the employers that were there said, we may not be able to hire certain age groups because of age or other restrictions, but we do have an opportunity to fund said programs or whatnot. So those conversations are happening right now. Here over the next couple of months, we'll be seeing more of that rolled out. I know the mayor just wants to make certain that we have all the data necessary and we know what we need going forward, so we implement something that's going to have long-term positive effects and not just throw something on the wall right now because it seems like the best thing to do. But those partnerships are being talked to right now.
If you don't mind, will everybody give our panelists a hand? Thank you.
That they shared. And now we'd like to give you an opportunity to give us some feedback and some input and some ideas. You're going to have a couple of other opportunities to do that. There's an event survey about the event in your book. Renee's going to remind you again before you leave. And there's also going to be an online survey you'll receive soon. But in the meantime, today, while it's fresh on your mind, while you've heard what's been said, the data, the workforce issues, and so forth, we'd like to get you to talk to us. I'd like to introduce to you Commissioner Stephen Mindris. He joined the Metro Social Services Board last year, and we're very pleased to have him. He served for several years as the Community Services Director at the Tennessee Department of Human Services. And he contracted with a number of agencies, including Metro Social Services, other government agencies, and other nonprofit organizations. And these were about services, that many of which we've discussed today. So I'd like to invite Commissioner Mindris to come to the stage.
Thank you. Hi. Some of this is the microphone and some of it is the booming thunder outside. So we want to wrap things up today by spending just a few minutes getting some feedback from you. There's a lot of collective wisdom here in the room. And it's somewhat daunting when you hear the kind of report that we've heard this morning, and then we've zeroed in with a focus on workforce development. You put that in the context of the mayor's remarks and her initiative and her interest. There's a lot of challenges and a lot of work out there, but I think there are opportunities and there's a roadmap that lies ahead of us. And we would like to, as Dinah said, we get a lot of feedback through Metro Social Services through consumer surveys, people and their feelings about the report that you've received. And before we start to talk a little bit, and I would like some participation, I will mention that there is a lot of available resources through Metro Social Services and Planning Commission. There's a lot of work behind this report that's available online, and also research and reports that could be helpful to you throughout the year. So please take advantage of what's available online. Again, this is just an executive summary, and some of you have the full report, but there's a lot more behind that. And we do know that you use that in your planning. You've made that very clear to Metro Social Services, and we really encourage you to ask more questions in the coming year about how planning and coordination could be helpful you in that regard. So let's spend about 15 or 20 minutes sort of thinking back over what we heard this morning and some of the implications for the next coming years. Particularly, you've heard a somewhat depressing report about how poverty in Nashville has sort of gone off in the wrong direction, where you see growth and tremendous opportunity in some other communities around the country, and poverty being decreased there and new programs being offered. Right now, we've seen sort of the other side of that in Nashville. So give me some feedback. So what did you hear this morning that really stood out for some of you? Or what were important messages that were made? Yes.
Mayor Berry spoke on the 10,000 youth working in Nashville. As she was saying that, I just had all kinds of ideas that just ran through my mind during that time. With youth spending most of their time in school, what I was thinking would be a great idea is if you had a job prep class, which would work toward high school credit and or college credit. For those, you have to give them some type of incentive for them to want to do it. And seeing that transportation is a huge barrier. You just have it in school, so the transportation, you won't have a barrier for transportation. You are there. It can count as a class for college and or high school credit. I thought that would be important.
So really impressed with her announcing this initiative, and right away it generated some ideas in your mind about what some of the possibilities could be. What were some other important messages in what you heard this morning? Someone else? Yeah.
I think I was most concerned about the need to connect to employers for those who are unemployed.
Connecting to employers.
We can have a lot of programs preparing people for work, but we need the people who can hire. And as a director of a nonprofit, I'm thinking, oh gosh, I would love to hire people and I have no budget, right? So, you know, I wish there were an AmeriCorps Vista program for these populations. I wish there was some kind of a way to allow those of us maybe who work in nonprofits and can't afford to continue to hire people to nevertheless provide first jobs.
That employer connection was talked about on the panel.
Yeah.
And again, we've talked a lot this morning about the interrelatedness of a lot of these issues. It's not just one thing, but again, that employer focus. Anything else that stood out for someone? Yes.
I think that, you know, when you look at
the rent burden,
which seems to be going up as poverty is also going up. We also have this issue of, employing people with jobs, and we have a lot of political work jobs. The issue of an affordable wage, I think, is something that we need.
Affordable wage, the rent burden, again, we talked a lot about that. The high percentage of take-home pay that goes towards very basic living costs in Nashville today. And that's not on the decline, that's just growing. What was the most challenging thing you think you heard this morning in the different presentations? What's going to be most difficult out there?
Funding.
Yes?
I think it was very interesting that all of the previous speakers also talked about the wraparound services, the need for wraparound services.
Wrap around.
Mm-hmm. The unemployment rate is so high, and then also with youth, the fact that we need more than just programs, we need a collaboration of different types of programs, from transportation to addressing the issue of unemployment, and it's as well as youth, because usually with the youth, you learn how to work early in life, and with
Now, when I was with the state, there was one definition of coordination that was used pretty regularly, and that is, that's when someone with more power tells you what to do. And unfortunately, that's often the case. We talk a lot about collaboration, we talk a lot about a coordination, but again, I think there are true challenges in how we pull that all together and make it happen on everyone's behalf. And again, the issues about private sector involvement in that. Any other challenges out there that really stand out? Yes?
How work is a case manager for low-income elderly, and that is a real challenge.
Low-income elderly.
Because workforce development is not a lot of them. They can't go back and forth. But they've got challenges almost every month, paying their electric bill, paying their rent. And, you know, I don't know what the answer is, because I had someone ask me last week,
that workforce need is on a continuum. And we've heard some focus this morning about youth and the issues with first jobs and with young people, but you see it on the backside with older people that are looking to get back into the workforce or improve. So again, the challenge is being sensitive to that needs of everyone along that workforce continuum. Yes, yeah.
I'm Karen Weaver, I'm with Nashville State Community College. I think one of the challenges that I'm feeling is, how do we create a place where we can continue to talk about the needs and the people who might be able to help? Folks on the panel were talking about certification programs. Nashville State has lots of certification programs. Promises offering some money so that people can come to community college. We now have some trying to raise funds for adult scholarships. We've got some resources. And I guess my question is there a way that someone could create a virtual conversation where we can continue to throw our needs out there and also what we offer?
There are lots of players out there, and again, opportunities to be a part of this, but how best do you plug into that? And that's a great idea, to have a virtual discussion that might be part of that. And I'm not interrupting people, I just want to try and reflect back what you're saying so everyone can hear it. Yes?
One of the issues that seems to be hovering in the background of the city is that we offer tax incentives to businesses and to hotels, but there are never any real links to requiring them to pay good wages, like to hospitality workers and other things like that. Mm-hmm. If I'm having my tax dollars used in that way, I'd really like to see some requirements put on the people that are
Incentives again for paying that living wage and requirements, and again, how do you follow up on that? How do you enforce that? Yes?
The data presented clearly shows that the demographics have been changing, and we've been only almost 6 years. Although all the data show information about skilled jobs. For people that are not natural from here. But what about bringing also professionals that could serve those individuals that could be bicultural or bilingual? And there is nothing in the report about that. And I think that to take care of the demographics, we need to look at both things. Having jobs for the new Nashvillians, but also have the appropriate professionals to serve them in their own language and their own culture.
Language issues, cultural issues have been brought up before, but again, perhaps underrepresented in what you heard this morning. Mm-hmm. Other challenges out there, yes?
Michelle, I'm with Marion Medical College. I think one of the biggest challenges that we face in all of these areas that are truly, from my perspective, these are all social determinants of health, lack of housing, the food deserts, the employment challenges, all of these are social determinants of health. And one of the biggest challenges we face in addressing these just the silos, how much of the services that are available don't cross communities. I think that suggestion about the virtual conversation, getting that cross-communication going is critical, not only in addressing the poverty issues and addressing the unemployment issues, but in addressing the health of our community. We talk about transportation, we've got too much traffic issues, but then we have a bus system that drops people off
we're all driven by our funders or other sorts of political interests, and again, that impactful collaboration is a huge challenge out there and is mentioned many, many times. There was another hand in the back there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And our living wages must be a primary issue. There is no point for a parent to make nothing to pay for their housing needs just living wages is not going to help them. A living wage is needed for this family. Yeah. I just also want to mention, Ms. Dinas, you're really emphasizing on the mental well-being, and I couldn't agree with you more. When you're exploited, you're going to have depression, anger. You're not going to have time to be a good parent. And then the kids just have to suffer.
Yes.
I think another one of the challenges, I find, the front desk survey said that one of the biggest needs is, of course, the utility bills. We're struggling to find housing for people. We're struggling to keep people in their housing. And now in April, the electric deposits and reconnect fees are going to go up significantly. And it was actually expressed that this is used as a deterrent. The reconnect fee is going to go up as a deterrent from so that people won't miss their bill. Well, if you don't have the money to pay your bill, reconnect fee. And that kind of logic is just extremely flawed and only is going to make it worse for our citizens.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, one more, and then we'll move on. Yeah.
Paul, it seems to me that with a little age wisdom, that I can look back and I kind of see how we got here. And when you think about way our society is moving, there's some very troubling things that are occurring, and we're just beginning now to see the beginning of them. We talked about the need for skills. The world is a very smart place, and that's why employers move skilled jobs to places where it's cheaper. I was recently in both China and Vietnam. China is worried about losing employment to Vietnam, which is cheaper, and Indonesia is threatening Vietnam. So guess what? We are in a vortex now of a very competitive world. We also see a reduction in typical jobs held by typical Americans in both agriculture and manufacturing. They're gone. They're not going to be replaced. So only the skilled workers really have a great chance for survival. There will be challenges to get to that level, but it starts with the raw product coming out of educational societies situations, being able to be employed. We are in the trend. We didn't wake up this morning and this thing happened. This has been developed since World War II. And this is kind of a disturbing trend that we're in. Now, thank goodness we're in Nashville, Tennessee. I'd like to be in Detroit. There are trends, there are disturbing trends, but Nashville, Tennessee still has great things going for it. We just need to focus on what is reasonable solution.
And you bring up a good point about stepping back. And again, in whatever happens out of this mayor's initiative, the work of all of you in this room is again, short-term goals versus long-term value. And I think too often we do think in short-term rather than looking at the long-term value in what this community is going to look like in another decade. What were some of the key points that were made this morning?
Looking at the increasing amount of affordable housing, it seems like to me that a couple of things. One, is there some way we can stop the loss of affordable housing? Is there some zoning or some other things that we can do to protect what affordable housing is there? Because this daily eroded by unaffordable housing. So we need to look at that also, because just losing it.
Maintaining the affordable housing stock that we have or growing it, because the trend is certainly in the other direction right now.
And tying stuff together, if we start to develop affordable housing, why can't we use some of this unemployed people that we have get them involved in the development of affordable housing. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, so if you're more than one deal at a time, and somebody mentioned transportation, you know, that's a real issue of mass transit. So is there some way we could work with Metro Transit so that we can, you know, have enhanced mass transit to get people to where jobs are? Mm-hmm. Because there's getting to be more and more of an issue. You know, buses don't run at a time when people need to get to work. Okay? So it's right. Like looking at it holistically. And the other thing is that I repeat the words that Dr. Stephanie Bailey said when she was director of Metro Health. And that is, you know, sick people can't work. Okay? So we have to work to ensure the health of people so that they can work and keep their job. So we got to look at it holistically and work on these things and tie it all together.
There was a comment back here about a trend that this individual saw. What other trends do you see emerging out of what you heard this morning? What's coming? Yeah.
I think one of the tragic trends is that so many of our families are moving to Lebanon and Mount Juliet and other places.
Displacement.
This is so sad because we're losing a wonderful part of our population just because there's no housing and, you know, they can't get the jobs. And now they're going to have to get some, if they have a job, maybe at a hotel, which that's where all jobs are.
Displacement then at all levels. Yes. Any other trends people see emerging out of the discussion? Yes. Decisions are called for. I mean, what do you want to walk to? What needs to be done here? Yes.
So I worked in nonprofits for over 15 years,
uh-huh.
And I've been coming to these things every year.
Right.
And every year we have the exact same conversation.
Uh-huh. Same conversation.
They're shifting somewhat in the demographics. They're shifting somewhat in the economics. I think we look a little worse now, certainly, than we looked in the past, because becoming the it city is not really what you want to be when it comes down to it, if you're somewhat of moderate or low income. It just strikes me as shocking that policy is always absent from this conversation. My 11-year-old was asked to give an example in math class of how inequalities meet each other in real life situations to survive. And he said, really rich people need really poor people to work for them so they can make all the money. But really poor people need those rich people because, well, they have to pay for things like food and rent and get to work. He's 11. And he sees that.
Mm-hmm.
I pray to God that in 20 years he's not sitting in this room having the same conversation with the same people. Until we come together and address why we are trying to put more and more people into low-wage jobs so they can afford high-wage housing, we are never going to change this conversation. It's about policy. We have an incredible imbalance occurring economically in our city that looks the same nationwide, and it disproportionately impacts people of color. And if we don't stand up and start addressing policy, we're going to continue to pour hundreds of thousands of dollars into well-intentioned nonprofit programs that are just barely making it.
Oh, so there are a lot of that. So a real sense of just cycling through the same conversation. And so what are next steps? I mean, what is a more meaningful next step that some of you would like to see? Yes.
I'm prioritizing the most important needs and allocating the funds for
So where do those dollars go, and do they match up with the prioritized needs that are out there, and who determines that? What are some meaningful next steps?
I think that this is a conversation that may not have policy and systemic change, but when it comes down to it, you have to think about personal change. And part of what the city needs to do if they want to change these problems is they have to be willing to accept certain things. Like, it's nice that you want to say that we need to have more affordable housing, but do you want affordable housing in your neighborhood? Do you want affordable housing in your building?
Mm-hmm.
It's nice to say that you want things like better bus transport. Do you want a bus stop in your yard or your corner? If we don't change our attitudes individually, I don't know that we can change our attitudes.
So that personal responsibility, and yes, that acceptance of that we are a community, and that we all parts of that community need to share in a lot of these issues. Other realistic next steps or meaningful next steps? That relationship between the city and the state, and we heard people talk about the state shooting down what the city wanted to do regarding local hiring practices of contractors. So that tension is always going to be there, but how best do we make the most of that relationship so that the city is given some flexibility then to implement things that it wants to do. Any other specific or important next steps that any of you want to mention before we wrap up? Yes, go ahead.
People talk about the ongoing conversation. Will there be a way for us all to be able to connect with each other and know who is here to learn about one another?
Did people sign up when they come in?
We'll look at the registration forms, and our next steps is to try to convene a group and bring people together to further these conversations and make sure they're heard where they need to be, where people can make impacts on services and funding. So, yes, you'll be hearing more from us.
One thing we didn't talk about in a lot of detail this morning is that, as I said, a lot of effort goes into Metro Social Services putting this needs evaluation together every year, but it also has to be meaningful for you. And so that feedback is very important to make sure that next year's report and that interim reports and newsletters that may go out meet some of the issues that you're talking about today and provide you with the kind of data which is more and more critical to our finding solutions that are going to be helpful to you. So please take advantage of the resources that they may make available in the coming year. Well, I thank you all very much for being here this morning and for participating, and it's been a very important piece of how we look at how to handle these problems down the road. So again, thank you all very much.
Say thank you to our moderator, our panelists, our participants, our mayor, our commissioners for attending today, and thank you for all your feedback. This is the first time we've ever had audience participation, and I think it was great. You also have contact information on the actual executive summary of the CNE, so if you have any additional comments or questions, please contact us. And lastly, I'd like to say thank you to our planning and coordination group, our analysts, for all their hard work in putting this document together. Thank you. And that concludes our presentation. Oh, I'm sorry. You have a survey. If you fill out the survey and leave it on our registration table, and you'll also receive a survey online over the next few days. If you would fill that out, we greatly appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.